In games, there are lots of features that, when they're working correctly, can go unnoticed. A player might not even think about how many hours of development went into them. For example, camera controls. When they work well, you don't even notice they're there, and the game will play seamlessly. Games like Super Mario Odyssey have great camera controls that allow for navigating a stage and seamlessly switching between many environments. However, there are probably a few examples of games with camera controls that you're thinking of right now that lead to a nearly unplayable gameplay experience. Sometimes, a quirky camera can be part of a game's design, like in the Rage game, I Am Bread. However, other times it can be distracting and get in the way. The camera controls how a player will view and interact with the virtual environment. A good camera design complements the gameplay and contributes to an enjoyable experience. These camera controls are also interwoven with the character's movement design. As part of my open source Kinematic character controller, I created a set of camera controls to manage moving and controlling a hybrid first and third person game mode. The general design of the camera is to allow for changing the direction the player is viewing by moving the mouse or a joystick. It is also important that the player movement is relative to the camera to avoid becoming disoriented. These camera controls are designed with physics-based interactions in the Unity game engine. I have also added dither fading to avoid having the player camera clip through walls or the player model. This is sometimes not prioritized by a game's camera controls, but I find it to be much more pleasant than looking at the inside of my character's head. Different games require different camera and movement controls. Since I'm making this for an open source character controller library that can be used in many ways, I'll design the controls to include basic features that any game might need. Given this requirement, I'll need the camera controller to allow for the following scenarios. 1. Navigate and view the 3D environment easily. 2. Change viewing direction in a smooth and natural manner. And 3. Find and identify important information in the scene. These are common qualities any good camera controller for a first-person game like Overwatch would satisfy. The most important aspect of the camera is to display the environment around the player. To have the camera focus on the player, we can write a short script to have the camera follow the player by moving the camera whenever the player moves. The player's position is saved using where their feet are, so we need to save an offset position to move the camera to. If we want a first-person camera, we can put this position in the head of the player model. If we want a third-person camera, we can move this position above and behind the player model. There is also a bit of complex math where we need to pivot the camera position based on the current rotation of the player, so let's stick with the first-person view for now. I'll dive more into the third-person camera soon. To rotate the camera, we only want to change the pitch, or looking up and down, and the yaw, looking left and right. We do not want to roll the camera, tilting clockwise or counterclockwise, as this can be quite disorienting. When rotating the camera, we need to limit the maximum and minimum pitch of the camera, so we do not rotate around the top of the head and view the world upside down. This can be quite disorienting. Most decent games' camera controls will include this limitation, as it is quite disorienting and confusing when it happens. In order to bound the camera movement, we save a target pitch and yaw of the player and adjust the current rotation. If the pitch is beyond the bounds, we move it back to the maximum allowed value. This is normally called a clamp operation, as we squeeze in the value between our maximum and minimum. Now that we can move the camera to our desired angle, we need to adjust the angle by the player's input actions. For this example, we will use a mouse to control the camera. Every frame, we can check how far the mouse moves up and down and left and right. With Unity's input system, this is saved as a two-component vector, X and Y, we can read each frame from the input system. We can convert the left and right movement of the mouse into rotating the yaw of the camera, and the up and down movement to pitch the camera. We want the camera to be snappy and responsive, so I set the speed at 180 degrees per second, fully turning around once. However, I do allow for a mouse sensitivity multiplier in the settings to make this slower or faster depending on the player preference. From this desired pitch and yaw value, we can use the code from the previous section to rotate the camera to its desired angle. To view a sample of how this works, the camera rotates based on the mouse movement inputs. If we move the mouse left and right, the camera will change its yaw looking left and right. If I move the mouse up and down, the camera will change its pitch looking up and down. The pitch value is bounded as defined earlier to avoid the camera spinning upside down. We will also add in an extra input here, zoom level, that we can modify with the mouse scroll wheel. This will be for changing between the first and third person camera. So, what is camera clipping exactly? You've probably heard it before, but might not be sure what it means. As an example, think of a game like Garry's Mod, where you can use the camera to look through walls or doors. Sometimes funny, sometimes frustrating. Why does clipping happen? When a camera renders in 3D space, it uses what is called a frustrum, which starts out with a small square in front of the camera, called the near plane, and looks toward a farther out area called the far plane. Everything within this trapezoidal box is what the player will see on their screen. Camera clipping is when something is placed inside the near plane, so the camera renders the inside of the object that is being viewed or goes through an object. In a first-person camera mode, the camera will be inside the player, which is kept out of overlapping objects by the character controller. However, if we use a third-person camera mode with an offset position behind the player, the camera could clip through or go behind walls obstructing the player view. This can look unnatural and break immersion in a game. Think of examples of Minecraft or Gary's Mod I mentioned earlier. This breaks the gameplay immersion and can be quite frustrating. In order to get around this problem, we can draw a line from the player's head back toward the camera position, called a raycast operation, and check if we hit anything. If we hit something along the way, then we know to move the camera forward a bit instead of the full distance back to avoid clipping through or going behind walls. There's an extra step for the third-person camera controller. We can't simply have the camera be a constant offset behind the player, because it also needs to rotate with the player's viewing direction. If we rotate to the right, the camera should pan around behind the player, so it's always looking at the back of the player's head. Otherwise, we wouldn't be able to see where we are going. With some fancy linear algebra, we can multiply the distance we want to move the camera to be with the current yaw, which is the left-right rotation of the camera, to find out where the camera should be. Drawing a line in this rotated direction of the player's head will let us check if we hit anything behind the player's head. With this raycast operation, when moving the camera behind the player's head, we will avoid having the camera clip through a wall because we are moving the camera frustum in front of the overlapping object. It's sometimes good to add in a small buffer space between the wall so that the camera doesn't perfectly overlap with the wall as well. Once all these changes are added in, we have a responsive camera that can work with player movement to avoid clipping through walls. However, if we push back in too close to a wall, the camera will clip through the player model, allowing us to see inside the mesh. This can look quite weird and disorienting. To get around this final problem of clipping through the player model, we can do a second raycast from the computed camera position towards the player. If the raycast hits or starts inside of the player model, then we can hide the player mesh by changing the renderer to shadow only mode. This will turn off the player mesh whenever we are too close to the player, stopping the camera from clipping inside the player model. However, this change can be a bit abrupt and jarring, so adding a short dither animation where the player model fades out as we get close is a great compromise. In order to find if we are close to the mesh, we can draw a line from the camera's position back to the player's head. We can then check when this camera will collide with the player model and get the distance between the camera and the player model. This distance might be shorter or longer depending on how large the player collider is and the current pitch of the camera. Another interesting kind of fade is what you might see in Super Mario Odyssey, where the camera will have scenery in the foreground fade to allow the player to better view Mario. An interesting compromise to avoid clipping into first-person mode, but this does involve a lot of intricate level design. Now that we have all the parts of the camera together, let's look at the full process. 1. Save a desired pitch and yaw of the camera. 2. Each frame change the pitch and yaw based on mouse movement, ensure the pitch is bounded correctly. 3. Rotate and move the camera and player to match desired pitch and yaw. 4. Use physics raycasting to ensure that the camera does not move through walls behind the player. 5. Check if the player model should be shown, dithered, or hidden based on how far away the camera is from the player. Let's look back at the scenarios and qualities we identified earlier to check if we meet those requirements. Our first scenario included navigating a virtual space, which we can do by moving the mouse easily. Our second scenario included changing the viewing direction in a smooth manner. We define the smooth quality as avoiding disorientation and clipping. The use of bounding and raycasting helps us meet this scenario. The final scenario of allowing the player to find important information. With these controls, a player can easily look at an object or follow a moving object through the scene, so let's check this box as well. Our camera controls algorithm meets the basic scenarios and qualities defined earlier. There are still places to test or improve, but this is a great start to a basic character controller. Thanks for watching to the end of the video. The other videos in this series go over topics like player movement, design of character controllers, and physics interactions. Check out the playlist linked in the card or in the description if you want to see more of this content. You can find the GitHub project and code for the camera controller and full open kinematic character controller at the link in the description. There's also a website demo where you can check this out for yourself in the browser. I recently got a new microphone for recording the videos, so hopefully my voice sounds nicer than in previous videos. Make sure to subscribe for more fun videos and informative tutorials. There's quite a bit left to cover on other features in the character controller, and I have many more planned for the future. Have a great day!